So, Michael, of course, a lot in the news this week, but we saw another major eruption. Essentially, Baltimore exploded this week in the wake of the killing of another black unarmed man was killed by, we're not even quite clear. All we know is that Freddie Gray got put into the back of a police vehicle, and when he came out, his larynx and 80% of his spine, his voice box was crushed, and 80% of his spine was crushed. He went on to die. This is a guy who had done nothing wrong. He ran when the cops came up on him, but that's indicative of what's going on in those neighborhoods. The six officers connected to the Gray case are on desk duty and being paid. We know that Baltimore has paid out a lot of money over the years. And earlier this week, the city erupted in what, you know, I think it's fair to call a riot.
Absolutely. And also demonstrations, and also speaking from church pulpits and community organizing. And, you know, one of the things that struck me, I just saw right before we went on, I saw somebody share a clip of a young woman in Baltimore calling out a national reporter saying, how come you guys only show up here when there's a disaster, when there's a catastrophe? In the sense, every day in these environments is sort of a slow motion catastrophe and disaster. And, you know, I think that there's obviously a lot of different parts to it. There's a culture of police brutality and abuse. There's racism and systemic injustice. But there's also a permanent underclass that are concentrated in these areas. And it goes to our urban policy. It goes to deindustrialization. It goes to really the fact that we have policy built in such ways that makes certain lives expendable. And that's really the fundamental issue.
Yeah, and you know, it's interesting, you know, and this is, I mean, I want to be careful here. Obviously, you know, to a large extent, and, you know, we have talked about this, to a large extent, to look into the sort of the morality or the rationality of this type of violent outbreak is to really miss the point. Ta-Nehisi Coates writing in The Atlantic described it as saying that a forest fire is somehow wrong in what it does. I mean, the reality is this is a question of physics. If you oppress a community for a long enough time, and then there is an opportunity where they can feel empowered in some fashion, even if a part of that is self-destructive. You know, obviously, you burn down a CVS, that means that somebody's parents, that your parents or that your kids or that your friends or your grandparents can't go get their medication there, can't go get diapers there, whatever it is. It is not exactly the most constructive thing in the world to do. But that's asking almost the wrong question. I mean, the question is, you know, why is this happening? What is the action that causes this type of reaction? And, you know, to a large extent, people made the point that, look, the violence doesn't start earlier this week on, Monday, during the funeral of Freddie Gray. And we should say that the Gray family did not, had called for no protests on that day, had called for no violence. But the violence doesn't start on that day. I mean, the violence doesn't even start when these five or six policemen had Freddie Gray in custody and he comes out virtually dead. And ultimately dies from the way that he's treated by. The violence starts years and years ago. And whether it is sort of the situation with the Gray family, the two kids getting lead poisoning, because I guess lead rules just they don't apply in that neighborhood, or whether it's you know the harassment that makes this kid as soon as you see the cops run, even though he's got nothing on him, that he's done nothing wrong. So the violence started way before we saw the pictures of it on TV.
That's exactly right. And I think that the other really important points to highlight too are, first of all, what is the origins of the situation, as you pointed out? And then secondly, why are people so eager and so quick to get to this conversation about morality, this conversation about ethics, which all, as we know, all that's doing is obscuring the real issues at play. And the second thing, the other thing I just want to add really briefly is, you know, I know people who, and I'm sure I've done it myself, might, you know, get livid if they feel like someone at an airport ticket counter has been disrespectful to them, or they have to wait too long for, you know, customer service on the phone. And to sort of sit and in passive judgment of people who are regularly on the receiving end of surveillance and harassment and all sorts of other things. Again, it doesn't justify, but it certainly contextualizes. And it's really just the wrong conversation to have.
What does come out of violence like this, it's not necessarily what people think, frankly. But you say, you know, when we talk about morality and rationality, that it obscures the real questions. Well, frankly, I'm not convinced that's why we hear that talk.
Of course.
It is far easier to say the individual morality of these people, they're thugs or they're depraved or they only have one parent or they have a lack of morality. That is a great response if you want to avoid what is really society's responsibility, not just in terms of creating that, but even more importantly, to fix it. And we know what it would take to fix something like this. It would take a massive amount of resources. We just simply choose not to expend it. I mean, that's the bottom line.